I am going to introduce the moderator of the panel. Matt James is a visiting scholar at the David and Lucille Packard Foundation. I have to say in introducing Matt that and the panel that communicating about climate change is something I've focused on for a long time, and the Climate Reality Project is here, and one of the co-hosts, Ken Berlin, our CEO, I introduced earlier. I want to thank my colleagues at the Climate Reality Project and some of the CDC grantees who didn't have funding to get here. The Climate Reality Project stepped up and helped them with their travel to get here, so we appreciate that. Matt James has decades of experience in communications, also in grant-making strategies. He has ensured in a very creative way that new and powerful voices are heard in the areas of climate and sustainability. He founded Next Generation, a research and policy nonprofit, and serves on the board of the CDC Foundation. So please welcome Matt, and he will introduce the panel. Thank you.
Thank you, Vice President Gore. This has just been an incredibly full day. And before we dive into this final session, let me be one of the last people here to thank Vice President Gore for the amazing day, his staff for what they have done to pull together. President Carter, one of my personal heroes and the first man I voted for in a presidential election, so to hear him speak was just absolutely amazing. And I was living in Michigan and could have voted for Jerry Ford, so I made the right choice. This is the last panel, and we stand between you and whatever stands for happy hour and all sorts of other things, so we have to be interesting. And this is the time in many of these sessions where everything has been said, but not everybody has said it yet. And what I'm hoping is that this panel, and I know from this panel, that we are, I have to give tribute to Mo Udall, one of my bosses for that line, actually, that we are gonna take on some other subjects that haven't been talked about before. Now, I've spent my career in politics, policy, and communications, and for most of that time, I was focused on health policy and kids and families issues. But I must admit my journey sort of to being a climber convert in terms of where I want to spend my time and my energy and resources was started with an inconvenient truth. I'd always been an environmentalist, but in seeing that movie, that really shook me and took me to a different level, both in terms of what I did personally and also what I wanted to do policy-wise. And then I was literally pushed over the edge by reading Bill McKibben's incredible article in Rolling Stone, which woke up a lot of folks who had not been paying attention before. Now, I tell you that because it emphasizes why communications is so important to make progress on climate change. We live in a world where everybody is very busy, where the average person is worrying more about their kids, about their families, about their jobs. They're not thinking about rising sea levels. They're not thinking about melting polar ice caps and the like. I'm now spending my time at the Packard Foundation, where I'm focused on building philanthropic support for fighting climate change. And we're starting with health philanthropy because frankly, there is more money in health philanthropy than in any other sector, and also because we have heard very strongly today the connections between health and climate are just so apparent. And mostly health philanthropy has been absent from being involved in the climate change funding. I really appreciated what Jalone bringing up the role of philanthropy in climate. Just another fact for you to walk away from. Currently, 2% of philanthropic spending globally is dedicated to climate change, and that has to change. Because as we heard today, climate change is not just about the environment, it's about gender, it's about equity, it's about kids, it's about our aging population and how well they survive going into the future. It's about social equity, it's about migration, it's about security. So what we are trying to do is to grow that philanthropic pie, bring them all in so that we can address climate change and grow that pie significantly. Now, one of the reasons the health lens is so important is that in many cases, as we heard today, this is what makes climate change real to the average person. Whether it's increased in humidity, vector-borne diseases, the challenges to a healthcare system that Gary talked so strongly about, climate change makes this real, which is why I'm really delighted to have the opportunity to moderate this panel. The three people you're gonna hear from today all bring very unique experience and expertise and knowledge to healthcare and climate communications. Now, you've all had a chance to see their bios, so I'm not going to go into all the details of the great things they've done. So let the record just show they've all went to great schools, they've all spoken at great conferences, they published widely, and as the best of my knowledge, they're really good to their friends and family. Now, I can do a little bit better than that. And if we could get the panelists to come and take their seats while I do these introductions. First, we're going to hear from Ed Maybach. Ed is a widely recognized expert in public health and climate change communication. He is the Distinguished Professor of Communication at George Mason University and is the director of the Center for Climate Change Communication at George Mason. Now, I have a little history in communications myself, but I can tell you I always learn something new when I talk to Ed. After Ed, we're going to hear from Dr. Susan Pacheco, who is a new friend of mine, who trained with the Climate Reality Project and is focused on educating people about the threats to human health associated with climate change. Dr. Pacheco is an associate professor at the University of Texas Health Sciences Center, specializing in pediatric asthma, allergy, and immunology. Now, after Susan, we're going to hear from Jerry Taylor. Jerry is currently president of the Niskanen Center, a DC-based think tank that advocates for market environmentalism and the adoption of a carbon tax system to combat global warming. Now, I think Jerry is a very important voice in explaining how to best communicate to libertarians and conservatives about climate change and how we can best engage them in this discussion. And this is truly, I think, important because while I started this by saying it was Al Gore and Bill McKibben who helped bring me along my climate journey to where I am today, there are other folks we have to bring along who need to hear those messages from different messengers and packaged in the right way, and if we're going to win this battle over time. And I'm also glad, and final note before we turn to the panel, that hope has been mentioned there. There has never been successful campaigns done in basically changing major issues like climate change unless we offer people hope. My father has opens a lot of dinners with us, with friends and family, saying, Matt's not going to talk about his work tonight because he doesn't want to depress everyone. We need to give people hope. And so here we are. Hopefully we'll get some of that from this panel. So let me turn it over to you, Ed.
So let me start by acknowledging the obvious. And the obvious is that climate change is complicated, really complicated. And from a communication perspective, complication is an anathema to effective communication. So for those of us who understand that climate change is harming the health of Americans, the health of people around the world, and we would like to share that knowledge with others, we have to find ways of making the complex simple. So my aim in the next several minutes is to offer you up three simple, clear messages for your consideration. I'm going to sort of walk you through how I got to those three messages, and I hope that you will find them to be of value. So for all public health people in the room, you know this to be true. Every major public health victory of the last century has had effective communication at its heart. And effective public health communication looks like simple, clear messages repeated often through a variety of trusted voices. So I want to break that down for you. Why must the messages be simple and clear? Well, the way the human mind works, it doesn't deal well with complexity. It doesn't deal well with lots of words. The less we say, the more we're heard. A logical extension of that idea, the less we say, the more we're heard, we gotta pick very carefully what we choose to say. So we've got to say the things that will have the most value. Share the information with members of our target audience that has the most value to them in understanding the issue in the way that we hope them to understand the issue. And the third sort of logical extension of that first idea is that we can use audience research as a tool to help us identify which pieces of information will have most value to members of our target audience. Why do we have to repeat them often? Isn't that just annoying? Yes, it is annoying, but repetition is the mother of learning. It is also the mother of liking and the mother of trust. Philosophers have known this for at least 2,000 years. Communication scientists, we've only been around 60 or 70 years, but we've certainly known it very clearly during that period of time. So it's incredibly important that we say it over and over and over again. We don't have to say it in the same way every time. We can elaborate it, we can adapt it. But it's incredibly important that we find ways to repeat the messages over and over and over again, because as is sort of directly suggested in the quote on the bottom of my slides, it's only when we are absolutely at our wit's end, feeling like we can't possibly say it again, that members of our target audience will have heard it for the first time. And why a variety of trusted voices? Because communication, education is never effective and in any other context other than a context of trust. And the important thing for those of us in this room is that you, America's health professionals, you are trusted voices in your community. Our community, doctors, nurses, we are among the few sort of institutions in America that are still highly trusted. We're living in an age of unbelievable erosion of public trust, but the public still trusts you. And on the issue of climate change, the public trusts you above all others. They want to hear what you have to say about how climate change is relevant to our health. The value of you articulating simple, clear messages is that if you can do that, if your messages are simple and clear enough, members of your target audience will start to internalize them and use those messages themselves horizontally with members of their friends and family networks. And the only people more trusted than you are friends and family members. So another value of a simple, clear message is you maximize the odds that members of your target audience will start sharing the message with those in their social network. So what do we know about public understanding of the reason why we are here today, that climate change is bad for our health? Well, we know that top of mind, almost no Americans can name a single reason, or a single way in which climate change harms our health, or a single group of Americans who are at greater risk than any other. In other words, most Americans know almost nothing about the ways in which climate change is relevant to our health and well-being. We tend to see it, we being Americans, we tend to see this as a distant problem, distant in space. It's happening somewhere else, it's not happening in my community. Distant in time, it's a 22nd century problem perhaps, it's not today's problem. And distant in terms of species. This is a plants, penguins, and polar bears problem, it isn't a people problem. All three of those are factually incorrect, but nevertheless, that is the way people the average American sees climate change. They see it as an environmental problem. They see it as a scientific problem. They see it as a political problem. They do not see it as a human health and well-being problem. In short, I would suggest, went by that one too quickly. I would suggest we have a framing problem. The frame in which Americans tend to see climate change is, as I said, plants, penguins, and polar bears, an environmental problem, or a scientific problem, or a political problem. None of those problems, okay, so about a third of Americans see themselves as environmentalists. We might engage them effectively, talking about an environmental problem, but certainly a scientific and a political problem turns most people off. The problem that you have the capacity to share with the public is that climate change is a human health problem. Climate change affects our children, it affects our parents, it affects all of us. And that is an inherently more engaging frame. So not all people are the same. That is another communication truism. In our research, we found that there are six distinct worldviews about global warming out there in America. We call the six audience segments Global Warming Six Americas. The only Americans who know anything about the ways in which climate change affects our health, they're all in the alarmed segment on the left-hand side of the screen. The folks on the extreme right-hand side of the screen that we call the dismissive, it will be a very long time before they accept climate change as any kind of problem, much less a human health problem. But all those four segments in the middle, those are your target audience. Those people have open minds. They know very little, they know virtually nothing about climate change as a human health problem, but they're listening and they want to know what you know. Bingo. Okay, so this slide's a little bit busy. Let me walk you through it. We've used our data collected over the past decade to try to identify what are the beliefs that are consequential. What is the information that is true that is worth sharing? We started that analysis by looking at what we believe are appropriate attitudes and actions. Those are the bubbles over on the right-hand side of the slide. So one of those beliefs is simply one of those attitudes is the belief that we should be responding to this problem as a society. The second one is support for specific policy solutions. And the final one are the ways in which some Americans are rolling up their sleeves and engaging as part of the solution. Engaging as a citizen in political actions or engaging as a consumer in consumer actions. We found that there are five key ideas that are strong predictors of those appropriate attitudes and behaviors. People have to understand that climate change is happening, it's real. They have to understand that it's human caused, it's us. They have to understand that it's relevant to their lives, it's bad for people. They have to understand that it's solvable, there are things we can do about it, there's hope. And the most fundamental belief of all, the one that we now call a gateway belief, is they have to understand that there's a consensus among the climate scientists that human-caused climate change is happening. The Americans who hold these five key beliefs are much more likely to be engaged to show these positive attitudes and be engaged in these appropriate actions. So let me connect now, let me sort of offer you up the three messages that I promised. The ways in which health professionals can reinforce and amplify all five of those key beliefs can be done through three simple, clear messages. The first message, I actually was trained by Mr. Gore in his second training in 2006 to give a Climate Reality Project presentation. I found very quickly that as a public health professional, I didn't feel really qualified to give the kind of presentation Mr. Gore gave. But yet, I quickly came to realize, as a public health professional, I have a place of strength that I can work from that made me very comfortable talking to public audiences about a very complicated topic that I was still only learning myself. And this first message was essentially, has always been, the platform for my public communication. It's the fact that I am not a climate scientist. I don't need to be a climate scientist to understand, to know, based on the studies, that at least 97% of the world's climate scientists are convinced that human-caused climate change is happening, and that's enough for me, as a public health professional, to move on with my decision-making about how I can help prevent people from being harmed by it. So that's a really important message, because we know that that's the most fundamental belief that engages Americans in thinking about this issue. Most Americans think that there's a lot of disagreement among the experts. So reinforce the fact that, in fact, there is an expert consensus. Use a number. Our research has shown that number is very helpful, 97%. The real value added that you as health professionals can bring to this conversation is explaining to the American people the ways in which climate change is bad. It's harmful to people. You are the experts in that domain. You're not experts on plants, penguins, and polar bears. You're not ecologists. You are experts on human health and well-being. And that's the story you need to tell. You need to tell that it's not a threat. It's not only going to be harming our health in the future, but as was clearly documented in the National Climate Assessment last year, climate change is harming the health of Americans in communities across America already. And not all Americans are as likely to be harmed as others. There are certain among us who are being hurt first and worst. Previous speakers today have told us all about that. Most people care when a fundamental, when inequity is occurring. So to identify that the people who are being hurt first and worst, particularly our children, particularly our parents, the poor, people with chronic illness, that really helps people understand why climate change is bad for people. And then finally, there's the what we can do about it. There's hope. We have to offer people the hope in order to keep them engaged in this conversation. And health professionals have a wonderful opportunity to do that, because the single most important thing that we can do to limit climate change so that we don't get so that we aren't needlessly hurt, is to accelerate the inevitable transition to clean, renewable energy. And the beautiful thing about doing that is we don't have to wait for climate benefits in 50 or 100 years. We benefit immediately by cleaning our air and our water. And even members of the dismissive segment that I introduced you to briefly a moment ago, even they accept that the fundamental value proposition of cleaning up our fuel supply and delivering clean air, clean water, and better health. So even the 9% of Americans who may well never acknowledge that human-caused climate change is happening, they're still willing. They're actually quite, in very large numbers, very, very enthusiastic about the transition to clean, renewable energy. So those are my three simple, clear messages that I offer up to you. You can adapt them in any way you see fit. You can elaborate on them in adding what you know at the local level, at the state level, wherever you work. You can talk about adaptation, but these three simple messages, I'm quite confident based on our messaging research, these are exactly the pieces of information that members of the public need to hear from you in order to become more engaged in this issue. So thank you.
Didn't I tell you he was good? Thank you. Susan?
I need to stand up.
Okay, you can stand up.
You know, I know that I am one of the few, or maybe the only, that is standing up, but I'm Puerto Rican, I need to move. I need to use my hands. And if I'm sitting, I'm tied to the table. And if I'm here, I'm standing tied to the podium. So this is better than not being able to walk. But having said that, thank you to the organizers and Mr. Gore. If I figure how to use this. Yes. So anyway, the question that we have now as we finish this panel is, what do we do? How do we engage? How do we use this information? And that's quite a challenge because we need to continue to project the face, the human face, in the climate conversation. And the beauty of this group that is here is that we're starting to do that. So let me tell you about this young man. This is Alexander, and he's the same child that was in the previous picture. And Alexander's ears remind you, many of you, of some people that, a person that was a president some time ago. But anyway, he's very proud of them. Alexander has asthma, among many other conditions. And he's very bright, he's very happy, he doesn't care much. But his symptoms and his problem is so significant that he carries a backpack, and in that backpack, he carries an inhaler. So in 2015, when the EPA was having the hearings in Texas about decreasing the ozone standard, Alexander agreed to come with me and tell people that he had asthma, and because of that, he had to carry a spacer in his backpack. And his mother asked me, Dr. Pacheco, are we making a difference? And I said, you bet, because we're putting a face to a problem that we know. So what I'm going to do here in my next 7 minutes of glory is that I'm going to give you my experiences, share with you briefly my experiences about talking about climate, my mistakes, all of the things that I learned, the tools that I use, which are basically stories, are personal stories, patient stories. I use my patients, and some of my experiences. So food for thought, and I'm not going to repeat those because you've heard some of them before, and you've seen some of them before, and I'm going to touch briefly on each of these issues. But I think this is one of the most important slides because, please read the line in the middle, away from formal schooling, most people get information about what they learn and climate change from the media. And the media knows that stories and narratives are important and that they make a connection, a better connection in the individual's mind. So it's a tool that I think that we must use. Now, this is a slide that I prepared many years ago. I wanted to talk about EPA, the new regulation, 2009 regulation, and endangerment findings. So I started with this story, and I said, you know, I said later, well, you know what, who cares, is what, in 1305, this happened. In reality, my message is the one that is there. I want people to remember that. Now, Let's go to how do I frame the conversation? I use the United Nations Declaration of the Rights of the Child, and some of you know that I am a pediatrician, so these are all children's, to frame the conversation in the context of what we care and what we must do. The other thing that I want to share with you is that we started at the University of Texas Medical School under the direction of Dr. Thomas Cole, a course for medical students, and I don't know how many, I'm sure many of you know that medical students are very difficult to engage. But what we're doing is that we're using the humanities as a bridge between their knowledge, in this case, and climate change, and their spiritual convictions and values. And I think that we're starting to see some positive changes. Now, vulnerability. You see, under these circumstances, I would be moving here and walking and thinking, but I can't. Vulnerability is one of the things that needs to frame the conversation, and I use a lot of definitions and questions, again, because that puts the individual in the context of the problem and the frame that I'm starting to use. Bringing the problem to our own reality is important. This information here is impressive, 70,000 lives in 2003 heat wave, but if you talk about what happened in Chicago, 1995, we come to the realization that it can happen here. 739 people died in the heat wave in Chicago. And the same story with this. We know that in 2015, there was a heat wave in India, very, very devastating. But if you live in Texas, where climate change does not exist, we maybe will be more impressed by the fact that we had a dramatic heat wave in 2011. Now, take a look at this because the slide changes if we put another background. I have here the same Texas heat wave, and it's a different feel if I tell people that Will, who is 7 years old, has to wear a cooling vest because he has a condition that makes him more susceptible to heat. And in days of very hot days, he cannot go outside. So again, that frames what we want to say in terms of the message. Now, this slide is very important for me because we know that air pollution is affecting the brains of children, and we're having inflammation, we're having problems with cognition, we're having pre-Alzheimer's and pre-Parkinson's changes in children that have lived all their life in air pollution. And these are studies that have been done in Mexico, some of them in mega cities in Mexico City. So I frame this in the context, or I put it in the context of a mega city, and you cannot see the slide there, and what happens with the picture there, and a population of kids. Now, I'm going too fast for this. Oh. Okay, so we need to reflect. You know, where do we go now? We need to reflect. We need to reflect in what we're doing. We need to reflect in where are we going to do. We need to reflect, are we going to ignore the plea of a mother? And the other thing that we need to know is, are we willing to forget our divides and work for the common good? And you know that all of us have these barriers that in reality are not there, they're just artificial. Now, we as a health professional community, we have the authority of knowledge. We have the authority of evidence-based information, and we need to use that. And we can use that power because we are trusted sources of information. Let me leave you with two messages. One that I have here, this is one of a student, and I really want you to read that because it's very inspiring. But this is one of our medical students that just took one of the courses in the UT Medical School. And this is what she said at the end of the course. And it's very moving because, again, this thought process was not there when we started, and now her perception is completely different. And in the environment that we're expressing in experiencing in our context, I think that that is what's going to get us moving. Thank you so much.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Pacheco. Jerry?
Excellent. A month before Donald Trump announced for the presidency of the United States, the Pew Research Center did a survey of Republican opinion about free trade. Found that 51% of Republicans thought free trade was good for the country, 39% thought it was bad. In August of 2017, Pew did that same survey again. This time, 68% of Republicans said free trade agreements were bad for the country, 24% said they were good. Now, I could tell this story with different issues, and I could also tell it for Democratic surveys, but the point I want to make here is that for the most part, public opinion is driven by tribal political leaders, and the higher up the food chain those political leaders are, the more influence they have with their tribe. So if you're telling stories to partisans at odds with what they're hearing from their trusted political elites, you are swimming against a very strong tide. And that is the problem that we face. I'm talking about Republicans for a very specific reason. One, I've spent most of my life as one, though I can't very well put an R in front of my name right now. Second, I know them very well. And third, and most importantly, because changes in public opinion with regards to climate change are really changes about Republican opinion. Democratic opinion about climate change has been relatively steady for the past 25 years. When you see movement in public opinion, what you're seeing is movement in Republican opinion, because that's the only opinion that moves. Democrats and left of center and independents have been relatively steady about how they feel about climate change. It's real, it demands a government response and that sort of thing. What we find when we look at what explains those movements in Republican opinion is exactly what I mentioned. Academics have done regression analyses to see, is Republican opinion moving because Charles Koch spent more money this year, or because Earth and Balance came out, or maybe another movie came out, or maybe there was some extreme weather circumstance. Does it move with the economy? There are a lot of economists who thought when the economy is doing well, people are willing to spend on what are perceived to be luxury goods like the environment. The economy does poorly, we're less interested in environmental protection. No, none of those things held up. What drove Republican opinion over the past 25 years worth of data is what Republican politicians were saying about climate. So, if you want to change Republican opinions or right-of-center opinions about climate, you will have a far better time doing it if you can change what Republican political leaders are saying, and the higher up, the better. Now, that might sound like a very nice thought. If you've looked at Republican political leaders, that seems like the impossible task. But think back no more than a decade ago. In 2008, the Republican Party nominated a man for president who ran on an aggressive cap-and-trade program, and the party then backed him up with a platform in 2008 that in the energy and climate section could have been written by Vice President Al Gore. The Republicans adopted a platform no more than a decade ago that argued that we needed to move quickly away from fossil fuels towards low carbon energy with aggressive market policies to get us there. That's what pretty much we all believe. That was only a decade ago. Did the Republican Party have a problem swallowing that out of John McCain? No. Did it cause a great deal of anxiety or angst in the GOP? No. Why? Because there's one thing that's our friend here. We often suffer from the fact that climate is a low salience issue. People don't care about as much as they care about other things. But that also works to our favor because conservatives don't care about it as much as they care about other things either. They wanted John McCain as president for a lot of reasons. Climate wasn't one of them, but they didn't care enough about that to get that in the way. So that's something of a point of optimism going forward. Now, there's a riddle here, though, because in a report published earlier this month that Ed co-authored, it's not all that different from other reports I could have cited, but it's the most recent, so I'll throw it out there. 49% of Trump voters said the climate change is happening. Only 30% said it isn't. 62% of Trump voters support taxing or regulating greenhouse gas emissions. 48% of Trump voters even support a revenue-neutral carbon tax, which is what I'm in the business of promoting. So this is not anomalous findings. Survey after survey after survey finds that most Republicans, most self-identified conservatives, even most Trump voters, who for the most part are Republicans, believe that climate demands a response. But that doesn't really square with what I just said, right? Because I told you political elites dictate public opinion, and Republicans have been pounding the drum about climate denial for a good decade now, so we shouldn't see numbers like this. Now, we can draw two conclusions from this. Either one, the case for climate denial is so weak that it can't even convince the Republican base. That's one happy story. I'm not entirely sure it's true. The Republican base believes a lot of crazy things, believe me. I think the reality is that most people are so politically disconnected from policy conversation that they have a very difficult time even knowing what the party's supposed to stand for. You'd be surprised. Only about half of the public could tell you which is the pro-life or pro-choice party in American politics. Now, it's not because people are stupid. It's because they just don't care that much about politics. They, for the most part, tune in during presidential years and only vaguely at that. Was there any climate debate in the on the campaign trail this year? Only if you're really paying a lot of attention. Never came up in the debates, it never came up in the ad wars, it never came up in the back and forth. Climate was virtually non-existent. The fact is the Republican base hasn't really gotten the marching orders that they're supposed to be denialists. They haven't picked that message up yet. So what I think you should take from that is when you're talking to people on the right who are relatively politically unengaged, you're gonna have a far better time of it than if you're talking to a Republican who's relatively politically engaged, because the more politically engaged Republicans are, just like the more politically engaged Democrats are, the more you're gonna find them hewing the party line. So what we do at the Niskanen Center is we try to talk to Republican elites. The idea being that if you can score a few John McCains in our world, you have a fighting chance of really moving Republican opinion. And unfortunately, a lot of the sociological and psychological literature about what changes people's minds are not really engaging in elite opinions. They're engaging with non-elites, with general voters, with members of the public that are either here nor there. Nothing against people in the general public, but they're not members of Congress. And they're a little bit different. So talking to them isn't quite the same as following, you know, the best practices that you might get from people who study these things for a living. And there are a lot of people who study how to talk about climate for a living. But generally what I've found are those stories and those blueprints don't work very well when you're talking with congressmen, senior Republican staffers, or engaged activists in the Republican Party and the governing networks of climate in Washington, D.C. Now, I know a little bit about them because not only do I deal with them every day at the Niskanen Center, I used to be one of them. What you don't know is that for 20 years, I worked at the Cato Institute in Washington, D.C. I was originally hired to be director of their energy and environmental policy, and I became a vice president by the end of my tenure there. So everything that the Cato Institute did on climate came through my desk. A lot of the skeptic talking points that we wrestle with are talking points that I helped write. So I know a little bit about what motivates skepticism, what are the strong arguments, what are the sort of psychological things that they tap into, and then I also know a little bit about what can move you away from them, because I moved away from them. Over the course of 20 years of wrestling with the climate bear, I lost. And unlike a lot of my colleagues, I decided that when you lose an argument, it's probably best to drop your old position and adopt something of a newer one, which I've done. So let me conclude, because I know you have questions and I'm the very last speaker you have. So quickly, what works with Republican elites? Because hopefully you'll talk to them. First of all, if you talk about the need for massive socioeconomic transformation, forget it. Republicans kind of like, you know, the world that we live in, more or less. Maybe Trump voters don't. They seem to be pretty upset. But for the most part, they like capitalism. They like the 21st century. They don't entertain the idea of going back into a pre-industrial pastoral paradise or a Rousseauian sort of state of nature. Likewise, if you're talking about what's required to address climate and you start throwing around Bill McKibben's demand for the equivalent of World War II, forget that too. Republicans generally don't like unleashing government for massive domestic wars against the economy. That's not to say that it is not that the challenge in front of us requires significant action. I believe it does. But just keep in mind that your objective is to move Republicans along to action and not to scare the living crap out of them. Second, do not overstate the certainty in play here. There is a lot of uncertainty. Now, there's some things we're pretty certain of. We know that climate change is happening. We know that industrial emissions are virtually the entire driver. And we know it will have significant, serious, big impact in the future. And we know it's having an impact now. Those things aren't uncertain. So we can be very clear about that. But exactly how things will play out over the next 100 years, we have less idea than oftentimes we say. So, for instance, if we double pre-industrial levels of CO2 in the atmosphere, according to the IPCC, we will likely see temperature increases once they stabilize at somewhere between 1.5 degrees Celsius and 4.5 degrees Celsius. That is a huge swing. That is a major concession of uncertainty. And that's just the most likely story. Of course, there are low probability, high impact scenarios that can cause that warming to go 5, 6, 7, 8, 11 C. And there are also major uncertainties that could mean that instead of 3 or 4 centuries before we hit stabilizing temperature increases, we could see it in 60 years. We don't know. When we act more certain than we are, we lose our credibility with the Republican audience, because there's one thing they imbibe for a living, it's that there's a lot we don't know. And on that particular front, about how bad climate change is going to be in the next decade and the next century, they're on pretty firm ground. There's a lot we don't know. A lot of it even has to do with industrial emissions, have nothing to do with climate sensitivity, just how much economic activity we're going to have. So don't overstate certainty. What does work? I think talking about risk management works. It worked with me. It was one of the more decisive things that broke my old position, and it works very well on the Hill. The point here is that the climate debate tends in Washington to be a debate about the most likely outcome. My old friends at the Cato Institute would say most likely climate change will be a modest non-event where the benefits will about equal the cost. It's not going to be that big of a deal. We'll adopt, the economy will figure out new technologies, and the climate's not as sensitive as you think. And then they're in a hot debate with the IPCC and other scientists say, no, the most likely outcome is much more serious. But this is in a range of uncertainty. The reality is we have a big distribution of possible outcomes. We're not entirely sure what the most likely outcome, but we know there's a very large distribution. And what do you do when you have a large distribution of possible outcomes? You hedge. If you're in financial markets, would you put all your money in equities in every single year? Well, that's the most likely positive outcome, right? If you want to get the most return for your dollar, put money in stocks. It's the most likely best return. But nobody does that, or very few people do it. Why? Because we know that that might be the most likely outcome, but there's huge risk by doing that. Now, to give you an idea of how this can penetrate Republican craniums, just like it penetrated mine, Dick Cheney, after 9/11, said this about weapons of mass destruction, quote, if there's a 1% chance that Pakistani scientists are helping al-Qaeda build or develop a nuclear weapon, we have to treat it as a certainty in terms of our response. So Republicans are, just like all of us, are perfectly capable of recognizing that risks exist, that we need to be cautious about them, maybe even adopt something like the precautionary principle, which they love in foreign policy but not in environmental policy, and hedge our bets. That works, because you're not asking people to, you know, decisively say, well, Bill McKibben's right and Pat Michaels or some other climate skeptic is wrong, saying, look, man, there's lots of risks. And even the climate skeptics that get traction to give testimony on the Hill, they acknowledge uncertainty. In fact, they use uncertainty in their favor. But uncertainty also cuts against them as well. Thirdly, co-benefits work. We've heard all of today about the health benefits of addressing fossil fuels and carbon energy, because there are a lot of conventional pollutants that follow from it as well. If you want to know how to talk about that, go back and watch the old speeches from John McCain in the 2008 campaign. He said we should address climate change. When 98% of scientists tell you it's real, it's like 98% of your doctors telling you that you have cancer. You probably should take that seriously. Maybe you don't, but you probably ought to take it seriously. And the worst that happens, if we address climate change, it's not a real problem, we give our kids a cleaner planet. That works very well. He was able to get through the Republican primary of that, and they were some of the best speeches I've ever seen on this topic. That works. And finally, solutions that don't requiring the free market are destroying the free market are important. Because what's really going down here is that in my old world, there's really not a hot debate about climate sensitivity, the social cost of carbon, sunspots, or any of that. It's like, for those of you who have been married, I've been married twice, so I have a little experience in this too. Lightly said. The reality is sometimes when you get in an argument with your spouse, you think you're arguing about something, and you're really not arguing about that, right? You're arguing about something else. In the climate arena with Republicans and conservatives, that's exactly what's going on. You hear a huge debate about the science. This debate is not about the science, not really. The core objection from the right, from my old world, is that if you acknowledge climate change and the IPCC narratives as true, that is going to necessarily lead to de facto deindustrialization, massive energy price increases, and a massive expansion of government. And if you believe that accepting that narrative is going to lead to all of these outcomes, you will fight like hell to argue that this is not a problem that requires anything close to these sorts of responses. Now, it turns out they don't require those kind of responses. Because of the collapsing price of low-carbon energy, we can decarbonize this economy without causing great stress to global well-being or GDP. And in fact, it turns out Republicans and libertarians were put on this earth with the perfect answer to the climate problem right out of the Republican toolbox, which is harnessing markets and prices to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and carbon pollution. This is the near universal remedy embraced by virtually everyone who pays attention to the topic, and Republicans are perfectly positioned to put us in the play. Harness markets, free the markets, get prices right, and then let things play out. That works. I'll end it
there. Great. Thank you, Jerry. Jerry. And we're going to have time for some questions if people want to line up, and I'm going to ask, please identify yourself, and also please, because we have a short amount of time, let's not have speeches, let's have actual questions. Jerry, you know, your talk reminded me of another great old Mo Udall story he used to tell about the old conservative who was interviewed on his 100th birthday by a local newspaper, and the newspaper said, you must have seen a lot of changes in your time, and he said, yes, and I was against every damn one of them. So we learned on this panel, simple messages work, narratives matter, and putting people at the center of this, and that there are effective ways you can reach conservatives. I particularly like the risk management part of this, Jerry, because one of the things we did at Next Generation was the Risky Business Project. Hank Copsey, who is the director, is here today, and that really opened up different discussions with Hank Paulson and others to be able to reach conservatives. So with that, let me go over to this side, and we'll take a question.
Annelise Depoux, I am co-leading the Centre Virchow-Villermé for Public Health. It's a French-German center for public health dedicated to, in Paris, to climate and health research. And we had the privilege to host 9 months Rainer Sauerbaum to prepare the COP21 and to record 3 MOOCs. On climate change and health. 3 MOOCs are massive open online courses, and some of you have on your table one of these MOOCs titled Why Health is a Key for Climate Negotiations. You know that spread knowledge on this topic is very crucial. And yes, also in the end, recorded in this MOOC. So we all agree about the importance of communication, and the impacts on health can also be instrumental as an entry door to raise awareness on climate change at large. But doubt is a powerful obstacle to action, and doubt is now being spread from the Oval Office itself. Which strategy would you recommend to counteract this?
Well, if I knew how to counteract Donald Trump, I'd have a heck of a market share as a Republican consultant, since he ran through some pretty capable politicians in the course of the primary season and won a race that he had no business winning, as far as most political professionals were concerned. So I'm not entirely sure. My own sense of it is that there is less to Trump than meets the eye and his powers over the Republican base. Really, if you look at the vote totals in November, all you really saw is that Donald Trump got the Republican votes that any Republican would normally get. We would have thought that a madman like Donald Trump could not hold on to the Republican base. We found out the Republican base will vote for a madman as long as he's a Republican. I don't mean to disparage. I'm fairly certain we could tell the same story about Democrats. People are tribal in the same fashion. But remember, he also won in people to choose between him and Hillary Clinton, as much as I don't think that should have been a very close call. The reality is now he stands alone. And so Republican voters might have said, look, he makes me really uncomfortable, and I disagree with a lot of it, and a lot of what he says, and a lot of the way he says it makes me terribly uncomfortable, but he's not her. Well, she's not here anymore. And so I suspect that you will find that his ability to move the Republican base is far less than you think, because if public opinion surveys and whatnot are correct, he is now spiraling into historic levels of unpopularity, and that doesn't occur just because Democrats don't like him.
Lori Garrett again from the Council on Foreign Relations. This week, a bill was introduced in the House. It was easy to memorize because it's only one sentence. Quote, the Environmental Protection Agency shall be eliminated by December 31, 2017, end quote. Assuming that that's never really going to get out of committee and that's just the whack job extreme, where, Jerry, is the likely one that will go to the floor?
The likely what will, that will go to the floor, I'm sorry.
Bill related to whatever we shall call the Environmental Protection Agency, or maybe the Environmental Exploitation Agency.
So you're asking me
agency?
What fresh hell is coming our
yes.
way that might have a... Well, legislatively, there are two which require your attention. The first is something called the RAINS Act. The RAINS Act requires any regulation that costs more than $100 million, which is a large number of regulations every year, to be advisory only until they are affirmatively adopted by the House and the Senate and signed into law like the President. So what it would mean is, going forward, all regulations are nice thoughts. They're like proposed pieces of legislation that have to be adopted by the Congress. Even regulations that come from bills that were, you know, laws that were passed 30 years ago, like so the Clean Air Act, Clean Water Act, all that. If that passes, that would be a real gut blow to a lot of what we stand for. Now, as an aside, truth in advertising, I helped put the RAINS Act together 20-odd years ago at the Cato Institute. And I am not hopeful, I do not hope that it passes. There are some reasons I'm still theoretically sort of fond of the idea. But the fact is, that would be a gut punch. Now, that bill passed the House already, and it's now in the Senate. Did so in the last Congress as well, and it died in the Senate, so we'll have to see. The second thing to look out for is a rewrite of the Clean Air Act. The Supreme Court has ruled that the Clean Air Act requires EPA to regulate greenhouse gas emissions if they find that they are a threat to human health and the environment, as they have been so found. Now, there's two ways for the Trump administration to get around that. One, say, nah, there's no evidence that greenhouse gases are a threat to human health and the environment. We reversed the endangerment finding that came under the fiendish Barack Obama EPA. If they were to do that, they'd be subject to legal challenge in court, in which they would be slaughtered. So they kind of know that. So they could just rewrite the Clean Air Act, right? They could make it clear that the Clean Air Act does not govern greenhouse gas emissions. That is another possibility. That, I believe, passed the House in the last Congress as well and died in the Senate, though it hasn't really got much traction now. Those are the two big things to look out for.
Question up at the top. Wonderful. My name is Will Butler. I work with an organization called Unreasonable Group out of Boulder, Colorado, and we work with entrepreneurs who are typically developing for-profit solutions to address the effects of climate change. I'm not going to make a statement, but a request. I would love these slides, as we've been seeing today. There's so much information that has gone through. So if there is a way for the Climate Reality Project team to collect those, I don't hate to create work for people, but that'd be wonderful. My question, I've really enjoyed specifically hearing about this panel in regards to messaging. We've talked a lot about messaging to politicians and directly to individuals. I'd love to hear your thoughts about how we can better create messaging to the business community and how the scientific community can best interact with them. Because entrepreneurs, no matter how bad things get, see opportunity and see the upside. Thank you.
So politicians, business leaders, were meteorologists, another group I spent a lot of time working with, they're all people too, right? And so all of these information processing biases that we've been talking about, they're all subject to them. As long, a point I sort of want to add as a friendly amendment to what Jerry was saying earlier. Really important for people in this room to realize you can't solve the whole problem, but you have a really important play to role in resetting public understanding of the problem, whether those publics are elected officials on Capitol Hill, business leaders, or just members of your community. And so it's those simple, clear messages that focus the problem on things we care deeply about: our health, the health of our children, the health of other people in our community, and in general, people everywhere. That really is the unique value add that members of this community can bring. So I just want to make it clear that you have a really important role to play. Simple, clear messages repeated often through your trusted voices. Jerry, I was talking to him before earlier in the day, and I asked him, I hope you don't mind, when do you see the next window of opportunity opening up politically? And his response was, really difficult to know, but the important thing to do is prepare for that opportunity when it arises. And so the work that we have to do, those of us in this room, those people who are watching online, and everybody in the health community, you know, we're playing an important role in preparing for that window of opportunity that will open up. I realize I sort of dodged your question, but I really wanted to say that to everybody in this room.
Let me just offer two quick things. So I live in Silicon Valley, and as I mentioned before, the Risky Business Project was a risk assessment of different sectors of the economy and how they would be affected by climate change. That's a very important way to communicate to businessmen. George Shultz, you know, when he goes back and talks about the Montreal Protocol, basically sold it to Ronald Reagan as, wouldn't you like to have some insurance to make sure that if this is true, we have taken on insurance policy. The second is economic opportunity. There's a great organization, Advanced Energy Economy, that is basically a terrific organization for understanding what's happening in terms of renewable energy and where the jobs are growing. And basically businessmen are looking for that economic opportunity. I'm working in the water space right now, and I can tell you an interesting stat. There are basically 20 times more dating apps that are being developed, I'm sorry, dating businesses being developed in Silicon Valley than there are water startups. Once water, you start to see that and other businesses being developed where there's economic opportunity, that's how you communicate to the business community. Over here.
Hi, my name is Sarah Isaac. I work with Salter Mitchell, Marketing for Change, a behavior change communications company. Hi, Ed. first start with an aside that Reuters is reporting that 2 to 5 executive orders will be signed by the president at the EPA next week. So fresh hell coming soon. But I wanted to talk, I wanted to build on something that Dr. Mitchell said in the last panel, which was that the federal government has provided some really great leadership for the communities of practice who have built up in the public health sphere. So the BRACE community of practice, which has also reached out to other folks, and they are ready and eager and desperate for communication messages that they can take to their various public. So both to internally, they have to sometimes sell climate and health internally to the public health department, to community partners, possibly to even to the public. So they're ready and willing. We've been helping a little bit, but resources in the federal government in the best of times have been scarce, and these are certainly not the best of times. So given that this is a very key audience to tap, they know that their mission is important, but they don't have those messaging tools and capabilities right now to do their work. Who fills that gap? And that's my question to the panel. Who will step in to help arm this audience to carry that important message from what is a trusted source?
Well, I'll take a quick stab at that. I actually think that health philanthropy, the previous question was asked before, what is the role for health philanthropy? That's a great place where foundations can make a big difference in terms of help filling that gap. Ed?
So one of the, coming back to my very opening point, climate change is complicated. People tend not to want to open their mouth and speak about complicated issues because they fear they will be perceived as less than competent. Some really good psychological research calls that phenomenon pluralistic ignorance. We tend to think that we hold a minority opinion. We don't want to open our mouths and show that we are essentially standing alone or in a minority. And the reason that is because we don't want to be seen as incompetent. It isn't that hard to communicate the the human health relevance of climate change. We definitely need to do a better job of arming all of us in this community who would like to take this one on. But fundamentally, I would contend that the thing that is holding most people back is the belief that the dismissive segment that I showed in my Six America slide, who are only 9% of the public, most Americans think the dismissive segment is about half of America. And if they open their mouths, they're going to be caught between very strong-willed people in the dismissive segment and very strong-willed people in the alarmed segment, which is not a place most Americans want to be, not a place that most professionals, health professionals, want to be. The very first time I showed the Six Americas distribution to any audience anywhere, Senator John Warner from Virginia was in the audience, and he didn't even let me finish. His hand went up, and he said, "Have you shown this to, to representatives on Capitol Hill yet?" And I said, "No, this is the first time I've shown this to anyone." And he said, "Well, I can tell you none of my former colleagues on Capitol Hill believe that this is what the distribution looks like in their community." So the answer I'm trying to give is it really isn't as difficult as we fear. So just rolling up our sleeves and getting started with what we already have is going to prove to us that this is a communication opportunity that we can put our trusted voices behind.
And with that, I'm afraid we are out of time. I'd like to thank the panel. And if it could, we do have a notice here that they've added an after-hour session with Jerry called How to Talk to Your Republican Dad About Climate Change, which, so thank you, Jerry, for agreeing to do that. Thank you very much.